And Jim, why haven't you eaten dinner yet?
Because it's 6 o'clock.
You don't eat dinner at 6 o'clock, Jim?
I get off work at 5:30. Let's do this. I'm hungry.
Well, I mean, okay, good news is we already started, so welcome to the JimBob Show.
Thank Christ. JimBob Show. Getting after it. Early and often.
Early and often.
Love it.
That's Jim's motto.
Early and often. So that's what always, they call me. That's what my porno name would be.
Nice. So as always, I am Bob, and with me is co-host Jim, early and often.
Hi. Early and often.
That's
hashtag.
That's going to be your tag. Yeah, that's going to be your tag tonight, early and often.
Love it.
And so tonight we do have a guest, two guests actually, and they are from Rocket Punch Radio. They are some podcasters. They're also some Twitch streamers, and they do some charity work. I'll let you introduce yourself first.
Cool. Yeah, my name is James. I am, like you said, I'm a podcaster. I'm an author. Do a little bit of streaming on the side, just for the hell of it. I'm not really sure what to say about myself. I'm one of the main hosts for Rocket Punch Radio. We're a geek culture podcast. We talk about crap like movies, comic books, what's going on in video games, what's going on in just anything. If it's nerdy, we're probably going to talk about it. Like right now for the month of March, we're doing what we call March of the Mecha, where we spend the whole month talking about giant fuck off robots and the destruction that they wreak. So we've been having a real good month with that so far.
Good deal. Yep. And so with you is Samantha.
Hi, mm-hmm. I'm Samantha. I'm the other one. I'm one of the other hosts on Rocket Punch Radio. We do all those things, and I edit those things together and put them on the internet. So
I am the one that puts them on the internet.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, Samantha is our podcast producer. She's the person who actually puts the show together when everything's recorded.
Good deal. Yep. So Samantha, I got to talk to you after the show because this is supposed to be multimedia, so it goes on YouTube and it's supposed to be a podcast, but I haven't done the podcast side yet.
Oh, okay. I think that's probably easier than the video part of it, so.
Yeah, we haven't actually gotten into the YouTube thing, but we've talked about it.
Yeah.
And we have a YouTube channel with like 2 unboxing videos on it.
I saw Jay's unboxing, which was of the...
Jay's getting the smuggler crates for Star Wars, and he does those whenever he receives them.
Yep. That's it. I thought it was a bounty hunter crate for a second, but it was the smuggler's crate.
Yeah, I think it's the smuggler. Don't quote me on that.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was the most Isley's cantina this last episode.
Yep.
Yeah, it was.
Kind of an interesting fact is the he seemed very underwhelmed in the video.
That's Jay's permanent mode. He's perpetually underwhelmed.
He's chill. He's a real
he's
chill guy.
He's very relaxed. He's a very relaxed guy. You can count on him to not be alarmed by anything. He's a rock.
Well, I do want to say he was only underwhelmed by one of the pop toys, and it was the blue Snaggletooth. And he's like, wow, I'm glad I got the Obi-Wan Kenobi. But
he looked that up later and he found out that was actually a rare one, so he was pretty excited afterwards.
Yeah, nice. So is there I know you guys do Twitch, I know you guys do a podcast. Is there anything that you guys want to highlight for the listening audience? You know, we do have millions of viewers that everybody, they do tend to tune into our show more than anything else. So you guys,
well, like I said, right now we're doing March of the Mecha. So everything that we've got going on Twitch is going to be giant robot themed, and everything we've actually got going on at our website, rocketpunchradio.com, is similarly going to be all giant robot themed. We've been talking about Battletech. We've been talking about anime, movies. I've gotten to do so many rants about Pacific Rim, which always makes me happy. Our most recent episode is actually, it went up tonight. We talked about giant mech anime. In particular, the highlight of the episode was that we'd managed to get one of our podcasters, Nate, on the podcast. He hates Japanese stuff, like just straight up. And we managed to coax him into watching an anime, so you'll have to listen to see what he thought of it.
Mm-hmm. That sounds racist, James, and that's rule number one.
he's not racist about it. It's just he doesn't care for the media.
No, I totally kidding. I don't do the Japanese media. I've watched one anime, and it was Afro Samurai, and I only watched it because it had Samuel L. Jackson.
Yeah, I found the most anime-iest anime that I could find and gave that to him and said, here, have a good time.
Yeah, wow. It was.
That's cool.
It was a good one.
That is cool, James. We're super glad to have you guys on. And last time you were on, I think it was the shit. You were actually our first guest, real guest.
Oh, cool.
We had a good time. So let's do it again, right?
Yeah.
All right.
And I think now that March is coming out to a close, we're going to have you guys on as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, Jim, I don't know about your availability, but I would love to be on.
I mean, with a prestigious name like Rocket Punch Radio, how could we dare?
Absolutely.
Dare
yes.
Say no. I mean,
we have dozens of listeners in an average month. Dozens of yeah. listeners.
Just prepare your body, because we go for a full hour and we go hard.
Yeah.
Prepare your body.
Do you even cast, bro?
I'm envisioning being hooked up to Jaeger like in Pacific Rim. That's what Rocket Punch Radio is going to be. Bob and I are going to link minds, and I'm going to see all of his dirty secrets, and he's going to see mine, and it's just going to be wondrous. We're going to blow up the internet.
You won't even be able to look each other in the eyes in the morning. It's great.
I would have to say I would be Charlie Hunnam, whatever his whatever his last name is.
So does that make Jim Mako Mori?
Yeah, he would be the Japanese or girl.
I would rather be the brother who dies in the first 10 minutes. Spoiler alert.
I hope you guys haven't watched Pacific Rim yet.
I hope you have. It's a great movie.
Well, Jim just spoiled it for everybody.
That's okay. Well, there's still so the much. Yeah, they canceled the apocalypse.
Wow. Yeah, no, I mean, that's great. So speaking of apocalypse, I am super excited to talk about this next segment. And I'm super, because I do have a game that is related to the apocalypse. I mean, it's a great transition that I just did, and I want everybody to note that.
Quality.
It was A-plus quality.
It was masterfully handled.
And I do gotta say, I'm super excited with this new program I'm using. I can input sounds directly into the show. And I do want to give props to Golem and Goblin. They were the first guests to sing on our show. James and or Samantha, you guys do have that option if you want.
To sing?
I'm probably going to decline.
I'm amazed. We've gotten a high percentage of people that we've asked to sing. They just went ahead and started singing. One guy grabbed his dang ukulele and started.
Wow.
The peak of my singing career was in the fifth grade when our class performed the Mikado. I was cast as the Lord High Executioner, and it's just been downhill from there.
Wow, that seems very sixth grade oriented.
Yeah.
So let me play the sound clip and see how it is. It's going to blow your guys' minds. Are you guys ready? Are your ear holes ready for this?
My loins are girded.
All right, here we go.
Stop your play!
See? I love it. It makes my body tingle every time I hear it. And Jim
makes me feel
just
so good all
relief.
Over.
Jim sounds like he's heard this before.
Oh, yes.
Jim's nipples.
That's yours truly. Okay, that came out of these golden pipes.
No,
technology is amazing.
It did not come out of your pipes, good. Jim. We just gave the credit to Golem and Goblin.
What? Oh, was it them? Did they give it? Did they do it?
Are you
it sounded
kidding
like
me,
but whatever.
Are you kidding me?
I don't know. I thought I was a producer, but you already took credit for that, so I'm going to take credit for this. I don't even know. I'm just talking now. I'm sorry.
It's the hunger is getting to you.
Well, yeah,
his
my bad.
Belly is eating himself.
I wish. Shit.
Wow. So this is the part of the show where we talk about some of the games that we're playing. I know you guys don't do a formal YouTube Let's Play channel. Normally I tell the guests, do something that you're not playing on YouTube. So We'll start with Samantha since we started with James first on the introductions. Samantha, all right. What's a game that you want to highlight to, again, the millions of people that listen to this show that you want them to check out?
Well, you know, I don't think I'm guessing that the learned, very esteemed millions who listen to your show probably are already playing Stardew Valley. But that's basically my part-time job now because that's how much time I've put into it. So that would probably be my best suggestion. If you haven't sold your soul to your farm in Stardew Valley, you should probably do that.
So explain that game a little bit. I've seen it on Steam. I haven't played it.
Yeah, Stardew Valley is like, if you've ever played the Harvest Moon games from like the PlayStation era, it's very much like that. It was designed by, what's the designer's name, James?
Concerned Ape is what he goes by on Twitter.
Yep, he's a one-man design team, and he put together this really in-depth farming simulator where you farm and adventure in caves and marry a girl or guy, but prefer the girls, they're better. And it's basically, if you don't like your real life, you can give up your real life and play that game for 40 hours a week. But yeah, it's basically a farming simulator, but that, I feel like that sells it really short. It sounds not cool when you say farming simulator. Yeah.
I mean, to be honest, a couple things come to mind. Either Farmville comes to mind, and or Farming Simulator 2014.
It's much better than either of those.
If either one of those had a personality instead of the Farming Simulator game, it's probably not in my wheelhouse, but Farmville didn't have any personality. This game
had a personality. It was the personality of a pawnbroker, but it had a personality. Okay,
yeah. But like, yeah, I've been streaming it a little. James was watching me stream when I proposed to my girlfriend in the game, and the amount of emotion that I got out of it, he was making fun of me for. So it was
a little goofy how into it you were getting with this pixelated 16-bit girl.
I was really excited. It was cool. But so yeah, it's
been a long time since you've asked a girl out.
It has been a long time since I've asked a girl out. She said yes too, so that worked out okay.
well done. So is it more of a role playing game than a simulator game?
It's really, yeah, pretty much.
Yeah,
it's like it's a farm PG.
Okay.
Yeah, because you get up in the morning and you have to do your chores, but then you wander around town and try to make friends with the neighbors, or you can go adventure. There's a couple places to kill monsters and stuff like that. So it does a lot of things, but I think it does them all really well. But it's almost a top-down grid look. It's pixelated, kind of retro feel. But yeah, it's something that it's kind of a quiet game, like a cozy game, where you're never really in a whole lot of danger. You're not going to be on the edge of your seat. But it's about the relationships that you build with people, and you know, you have a growing your farming industry too. That's so.
Nice.
I don't know. It's hard to explain, but it's fun, and it's really not very expensive. I think it's like $15 on Steam right now. So if it seems like something that you'd like, it's definitely a good one to pick up. And it's... Yeah.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay.
No, I was going to say, $15 for a Steam game is actually kind of expensive.
It is. It is.
Yeah, entry level.
But I feel like, considering that I've had this game for 2 weeks and I've put over 60 hours in it, to me, that's really good value for money. So
that's commitment.
It is. It's kind of terrible. I hate myself a little bit about that. Like, I have a full-time job. I don't really have time to spend half of my life in this game, but you know, sometimes it grabs you.
Mission accomplished.
Yeah.
So anything else? I mean, Jim, I'm sure you've played this game.
Yeah, well, she said entry level, and that just hit me right on the head. I mean, $15—that's right up my alley. That's my wheelhouse, as the baseball players would say. I mean,
the hell out of 60.
I mean, I'm not super into farming or anything like that, but I mean, I'd give it a shot, I guess. I mean, the whole 60 hours thing—I don't know about that. I can't even, you know, keep a beta fish alive for more than a day. So, I mean, I don't think I'd be very good at that. I'm not so good. How about you, Bob?
No, I've not played this game.
Yeah, I feel like this is a game you can play until infinity. So if that's not up your wheelhouse, if you're not the type of guy who's going to get into like Minecraft or Terraria or something like that and like destroy your life by playing that game constantly, then maybe this wasn't isn't going to grab you the way it's grabbed me. But that's kind of how. Unfortunately, when I play games, I play them forever. So. Nice.
If you would have said infinity and beyond, you'd have had me. Anybody? Anybody? So what? Toy Story? What?
I get that reference.
Anybody?
I think my 5-year-old gets that reference.
Shut up.
She's not.
I'm like Kanye West. I'm a genius.
She's not actually 5, Jim. She's 4, and she gets the reference.
Oh, does she? Good. Fantastic.
So James, what are you playing currently?
I'm sorry, what was that?
So what are you playing currently, Mr. James Guest?
I am working my way through Persona 4 right now. I got the PS Vita version. I found out that PS TVs were running for $20, and that's $180 cheaper than a PS Vita, so I thought, I'll do that. And I picked that up, and I got the last of the Persona games in preparation for the new one coming out this summer. It's a JRPG, but really instead of like fantasy, like swords and sorcery and that sort of thing, it's kind of a weird psychedelic, almost a murder mystery thing going on. So you've got this guy that's murdering these people in really kind of gruesome ways, and you need to figure out who's doing it and why he's doing it, and you need to rescue his victims before he gets the chance to actually kill him.
Well, I mean, none of the games that I've played are that interesting.
It's another one of those long haul ones. It's, you know, it's going to probably end up running me about 50 hours by the time I'm done with it. But it's really fun. Like, the characters are super engaging, and by the end of it, you really end up caring about the story and everything that's going on with the game. I've played through a large chunk of it before and thought I'd try out the upgraded graphics on the Vita version. So here I am.
Nice. Yeah, I haven't dug into the Personas, and I don't think I have time and or the willpower to anymore.
Yeah, I'm enjoying that chance while I can before I end up probably with some of the same issues that you've got keeping you out of that.
Yeah. I mean, my long-haul games have really come to an end. So I bought The Witcher 3 and haven't played it.
Yeah, that's one that kind of demands your attention. I spent 6 months on I get bored of things within a couple of weeks, so I don't spend a lot of time on large games, but The Witcher 3 commanded my attention for about 6 months. You know, every time I sat down and I said, okay, I'm just going to power through the story so that I can just put this game away and move on to other things, and then I'd get sucked into all of the side quests and stuff, because this is one of those rare games where they legitimately put as much effort into making the side content interesting as they did into making the story interesting. It's a great game.
Nice. Yeah, I mean, I have played probably 2 hours of it, and it was awesome. I got to the point where you fight the griffin, and it was great.
Yeah, so you finished up the fun tax.
Yeah, and so you couldn't ask for a better game. I just couldn't devote, you know, 100 hours to a game right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I hear you. That's why I don't play MMOs anymore.
So what are you playing, Jimbo?
Well, in honor of March Madness, because I am a large sports fan, I dusted out the old cobwebs off of the that makes sense, of the original PlayStation that I still own somehow, and I plopped in 2000 NCAA March Madness.
Holy cow.
And I, yeah, right? If that ain't retro, I don't know what ain't. What is? I mean,
hey, it counts.
Retro gaming goes
back 2 generations.
There you go. I think Bob would highly disagree, but no, Jim, whatever.
No, you said Mass Effect 2 was retro, and I disagreed with that.
Well, I disagree with that too.
Yeah, that's only one generation.
Yeah, you guys can disagree all you want. It's cool. This is America.
It's not our show, so.
It's not my show either. Well, I can disagree with all the time. Anyways, but yeah, that's what I've been playing. I've been shooting a lot of threes. This was back in the day. Well, I guess they can't really. You can't even add the players' names, so you can't even create a player. That's how old this game is. So yeah, that's what I've been doing. No, 60 hours into this one, though.
Maybe since year 2000, you might have put 60 hours in.
Hell no. I didn't like that game at all.
Why are you playing it?
What?
Why are you playing it, then?
In honor of March Madness. It was the only one they had.
That's good to do.
Yeah, I didn't want to pay for anything. You know I'm a cheap ass, so there you go.
Man, you could probably get March Madness 2015 for 30 cents.
Well, I don't want March Madness 2015 for 30 cents. I want to play March Madness 2000 for free.
That was that was certainly the best year of a March Madness game.
2000, I think so.
Wow.
It was fantastic. What are you playing, Bob?
I'm actually playing two games, Jim. I'm going to do two tonight. You know why? Because I can. And I want to. So the first game is a cheap Steam game. And it's below entry level. I think it was under a dollar. It's called Dead Pixels, and it's a apocalyptic RPG. And so it reminds me a lot of Scott Pilgrim Save the World versus the World on Xbox Arcade for the 360. So you have a gun, you shoot zombies, and you collect coins. You go to vendors to buy stuff. You can upgrade your shotgun, you can upgrade your health, all that good stuff. So it's fun. I don't think I'm going to make it the game of the week because I'm playing an even better game that is so childish. It's fun. I don't get it. I bought Plants vs. Zombies Garden Warfare 2. And amazingly, that game has some depth.
I really liked the first one. It was a surprisingly good shooter for all that your competition was typically six.
Right? And, I mean, so I'm like, I'm wiping the floor with kids.
Old guy, it makes you feel pretty good.
Yeah, I don't feel bad because, you know, I'm usually first or second in this game. But it's surprisingly, like, a lot of fun. And it has, you know, a storyline to it. Not a great one, but it has single player, so you don't have to only play multiplayer, which is crazy. I mean, not a lot of games do that anymore, unfortunately. So before we have, I think we have 10 minutes, 8 minutes, 7 minutes. We're counting down. 7 minutes. I want to talk about this real quick because it is irritating me to no end. And it is news. We don't usually talk about news on this show, but we're going to today because the PlayStation news of PlayStation 4.5 is one of the biggest irritants I've ever had. And yeah. I'm going to go to our guest first because I'm assuming they share the same thing I do. But yeah. Let's find out.
Oh, my God. So, Bob, let me tell you a story. Once upon a time, I was a poor young college gamer who could barely afford to have a tube television, and I bought myself a 360, and I bought myself a copy of a Dead Rising. And you know, the thing about Dead Rising on a tube television is that you can't read the fucking text. So I made do. I played other games. I tried to avoid anything where I couldn't see the text, and when I had no choice, I'd sit real close to the television. Finally managed to save up for a TV, able to get a 720p. And I was good. I was fine. 360, PS3, whatever. I was okay. Upgraded to the PS4. Couldn't read the text. couldn't read any of my games. Again, having to sit right up next to the television. That TV started to die, so we bought a 1080. That was a year ago. So now Sony has announced the PlayStation 4.5, or announced, quote-unquote, just leaked the 4.5, which is going to be supposedly a 4K-capable gaming console. If they're treating this as its own separate thing and not just kind of a new 3DS or a DSi thing where the software is backwards compatible, I just bought that TV. I don't want to upgrade again.
Well, see, that's a completely different side of it than I was looking. My irritant is now you have a fragmented market, and
yes.
So mm-hmm. Xbox, I think, did it right with the Elite because it just has a faster hard drive and it has some more internal memory, but it doesn't really change the output. It doesn't change the graphical quality, whereas the 4.5, like you said, is spec'd for 4K TVs.
Right.
Well, and the 4K thing even feels vaguely unrealistic to me because at this stage, you know, it's pretty much just the one highest-end video card on PCs that can run 4K, and then it's not running 4K at a very high frame rate. Right. So, I mean, unless they've got some sort of miracle chip sitting in the wings waiting to be released, I don't know how they're going to be able to pull this off without it costing an additional, like, $800.
I'm pretty sure that this upgrade is based around the fact that VR is launching this year, and they want their consoles to be equipped to play these VR games and the VR systems that are coming out. And I get that, but I feel like game design in general usually tends to go with, you know, that if you're designing a cross-platform game, you're pretty much going to design it for the majority player, and yeah. I don't think they're going to sell a whole lot of these, you know, Xbox CDIs or whatever they're, you know, putting out new, because most people aren't going to have them in their homes. And I know that game designers want their games to sell, so they're going to design them to play on the stuff that people currently have. Because I guess we're not early days in this generation, but we're still pretty early.
Yeah,
and I'm frustrated by it because I feel like this is them trying to compete with the PC market, but I don't think it's the right way to go. I don't think it's the right way to compete.
Absolutely. And so that's one of my problems is the fact that I buy a console, so I don't have to buy a PC. I don't want to upgrade.
Right.
I don't want to have to stay current to play the best games. I just want to be able to put a damn game in and play. Whereas now with this, if you want to... So they're saying that, I guess, virtual reality will run better on the 4.5. Well, mm-hmm. You know, screw you guys, because I have a PlayStation 4. I don't want to buy a PlayStation 4.5 just to play VR. Don't do VR if you can't freaking do it.
I suspect that the 4.5 is going to be probably, well, you know, and I don't know how they're going to do this through just the USB connections presently available, but I suspect that the 4.5 is also going to function as an add-on to the 4. So we're potentially going to be looking at a Sega 32X.
Or the Nintendo Pack bullshit that they try to do.
I don't know how that's going to function. I feel like we are aesthetically past that point where we're willing to just like Voltron some other shit onto our machines. I just don't think that's going to fly. I feel like this is going to be a failure. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong.
Legitimately, at the beginning of this generation, all of the predictions on the market were, this is the end of consoles, nobody's going to continue to buy a console, people don't want consoles, and this was being backed on very good data that kids are kind of moving away from consoles. It's considered to be old man gaming now to have a PC or a console that you're playing video games on, because everything's on the phone. So people were already predicting the death of the consoles, and yet somehow the PlayStation 4 and the Xbox One still ended up selling like gangbusters. I feel like at this point, they're kind of pushing their luck. I mean, you're lucky we came to the table this time, but now you're wanting us to do this?
Right.
Well, and with the new Steam machines coming out where they can, you can put your Steam games on your television for the same price that you'd pay for a new or updated console. I don't know. I feel like they're dipping their toe in the wrong pond. I don't know. I don't like to make predictions because I've been wrong before, but I don't know. This doesn't sound like something that I'm going to put the money forward for.
Absolutely not. And it's kind of ridiculous because, I mean, so I have the Steam Link where it streams your PC to your TV via internet or your local area network. And
yeah.
I mean, it's okay. I tried to play Dark Souls 1 and it was laggier and shit. And it's connected straight wired. So it's not over wireless. It's not any of that. And it doesn't run well.
Yeah, yeah. I'm not completely on board with the streaming games yet, but I know at least with the Steam boxes, like the actual set-top PCs, you know, hopefully we'll be getting something out of those. But those are also kind of starting to look like they're going to be a bust as well.
Yeah. I agree. But
go ahead, Sam.
I don't know what I was going to say. It escaped. Sorry. Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's perfect because we're at the 30 minutes and we did not go over.
Oh.
Cool.
There we go.
And so I do want to say Rocket Punch Radio, James and Samantha, you guys were great. I really appreciate you guys being on the show.
Hey, thanks for having us on.
Yeah, we'll thanks for having
the favor
us on.
Sometime.
It was fun.
Yeah, definitely. And I'm sure Jim would love to be on Rocket Punch Radio with myself.
Of course. Of course.
If he can stand the insufferable nerds, we'll show him a good time.
We are all nerds at heart. So I do want to close it out with saying, make sure you check out Jim's Lunch with Jim. Make sure you check out Hearthstone Corner with myself, where I do a quick Hearthstone video from my live streams. Jim, do you want to talk about Lunch with Jim?
Nah. We're good.
I'll talk about it with you. It's where Jim plays a mobile game and uploads it to the YouTubes. And then be sure to check out our next guest next week. It is, I'm going to butcher the crap out of this guy's name, but here we go. It is Santifico. Santifico.
Sanctify?
No.
Samsonite.
It's
Slappy.
Santifico.
Oh, George. Gotcha.
Sure. Okay. George. Good job. Yeah. So he will be our next guest next week. If you guys have some sort of comment regarding the PlayStation 4.5, please, I would love to hear it because I could debate and argue and bullshit on this all day. And with that, I love you guys.
No, but seriously, we love you guys.
No, but seriously.
Hey, guys. Thanks for watching our show.
Hey, really, by the way, thanks.
If you really enjoyed it, press the subscribe button and the like button, please. And then check out these other videos that are magically appearing right now.
It's
Thank you.
Magic.